So good evening and welcome back to our third week of our six-week series. And so a little bit of an overview or review is that this is an introduction to the practice of mindfulness. And the practice of mindfulness is a very simple practice of using your awareness or your attention in order to do two primary things. One is to take a closer look at the life that you're living. And not the life that you imagine you're going to live in the future, not the life you hoped you had lived in the past, but the closer look at the life that you're living, which is always here. And this in your lived experience of here and now. So take a closer look. And Buddhists love a different language for that closer look. One of them is the idea of intimacy. And some Buddhists love the idea that mindfulness has to do with kind of intimacy with life. So with all the different aspects of life, to really connect with it in a deep way, see it clearly for what it is. And a lot of the wisdom that Buddhism puts a lot of value on comes not because you read a book that tells you some kind of useful knowledge, but comes from seeing our lived experience, seeing life in some deeper way than usually accessible in our everyday life. So it isn't some kind of strange capacity to see deeply, just taking the capacity of attention, of looking or being aware, and heightening it, or looking more carefully, or kind of using it to investigate, to understand. So that's one function. The other primary function is that there's something about the nature of attention or awareness in its simplicity, in its utmost simplicity, that is very liberating. It's very freeing. It's very refreshing. And because, you know, usually when people pay attention to things, right connected to that, sometimes even before we pay attention to things, we're already predisposed in some kind of way. And as soon as we notice something, there's all kinds of ways in which we relate or react to what we're seeing. And so some of those reactions are quite fine. Some of them are problematic and cause us a fair degree of suffering. And but there's always a kind of complication. It's kind of like you have a window. And a clear window is very simple. You can see right through it. You see what's on the other side. But often what happens is the window is smudged over, or there's dust on it or something, so you can't see all the way through. So the same thing with this capacity to see clearly. In its simplicity, it's like having a clear window. And normally our reactions, our judgments, our interpretations, our desires, our fears, our predispositions, our interpretations, our past history, our future expectations, they all very quickly muddle the water, muddy dirty the window. And so that simple awareness is not there by itself. And so on one hand, what we're trying to do is see more deeply. On the other hand, that seeing more deeply is also helping us to free our awareness, free our attention. So attention can be there in this kind of pristine simplicity. And perhaps the expression simplicity will seem to you as being simplistic. You know, why would you want something simple? You could have something sophisticated and wonderful. But when there's no smog in the Bay Area, you can look across the bay in that clear, clean air. That's pretty simple, and it's priceless. There's something very wonderful about it. So to have a heart that's liberated or free, or an awareness or presence which is liberated and free, is one of the goals for Buddhist practice. And the marvelous thing is that that this freedom is very closely connected to the capacity to pay attention. So rather than thinking of liberation or freedom as some kind of abstract thing that's far into the future, there's something about the nature of the simplicity of awareness which partakes to the whole wonderful experience of liberation that's connected to it. So we do this mindfulness practice to develop our awareness, to heighten our awareness, to cultivate and develop it, make so it's a bigger resource, a strength, a skill that we carry with us in our life. And one function is it helps us see more deeply. And as we see more deeply, we can see the forces that drive us, that motivate us, that push us around, the forces that we react to, And we can begin making wiser choices in relationship to that, so that the ways in which we contribute to our suffering, our pain, a variety of things, we can start making different choices. We can start lessening up on that. So seeing more deeply. And then the other is to discover something about the freedom that's found in paying attention itself. So that's so as we do this mindfulness practice, the way as I teach it, as it's often taught, we do it systematically, and it doesn't have to be taught this way. When I was taught mindfulness practice in Burma, in the monasteries in Burma, I showed up at the monastery and I was given a cassette tape and a cassette recorder player, and they just plugged us in. It was a half an hour, and in half an hour they gave the full instructions. And then I was sent to my room to practice for the next 8 months. And so you got, you kind of the full transmission in half an hour. So I certainly do that. But what we find is that it actually works better for most people to kind of get it, kind of work, kind of, it's so, human life is relatively complicated. So to get some sense of how to work with certain domains, certain areas of life, and build on that foundation to get familiar with more and more. And so at the end of 6 weeks, then you have a sense of what the full instructions are, because you've built slowly up to it. So we started with breath as the foundation. And then last week we talked about the body. Our physical embodied experience is a very important part of the mindfulness practice and certainly of Buddhist spirituality. And then tonight's subject is emotions. And emotions are a great topic. Emotions are connected to some of the most sublime, precious, wonderful things that humans experience, and also some of the most awful things connected to human experience. So there's a wide range that emotions, are about. And whether it's the positive or the negative, emotions are a very important part of human life. And given that, it's very important to get a sense of how to bring mindfulness to our emotional life, so we can see it more clearly, and so we can discover freedom in relationship to them, or so we can give freedom to them. And the idea of freedom, both if you can become free, you're also giving freedom to something else. It's like a two-way thing, or it's two sides of the same coin. So there's a certain kind of freedom that you can find, which will allow your emotional life to flow through you much more freely than it is. And that's a really beautiful part of the practice, when the emotions have this freedom. And part of that in Buddhist practice is, especially when we meditate. Meditation is a wonderful laboratory, a wonderful kind of arena, because it's a place to have very deep trust of our emotional life. And rather than thinking that something should be denied or repressed or judged or held on to, there's a very deep trust that what moves through us in an emotional way is somehow it's trustable, maybe not in and of itself, but it's trustable to let it move through us, to let it come and be there and move through us. And one of the reasons why it's trustable is that most emotions that people have, maybe all emotions, many emotions people have are a form of communication. And something's being communicated. So if you're really angry, something's being communicated. And so if you shut it out or push it away or deny it, then you're not availing yourself of what's being communicated. You're not listening to what needs to be learned or seen there. It doesn't mean you act on the anger, but you kind of have enough respect for it and trust in the process. You're willing to open to it to see more deeply. And what happens as you get a sense of how to do this in mindfulness, how to open and be present for emotions, there's a transformation of emotions, there's an evolving, a resolution, a movement of emotions that is very clarifying, very helpful, and also ultimately can be very deepening, where we kind of not just see the surface emotions which involve our life, but we start seeing some of the depth of our emotional life, and often it's not available so easily when we go about just kind of living our normal life. So tonight's subject is emotions, and as I start this evening, I know that there are people who have virtually have People have very strong opinions about emotions in our society. And people who have manifestos, you know, and people who are almost willing to fight about their opinions of what should happen with the emotions. They should celebrate their emotions. They should act on every emotion. They should not express any emotion. It's important to be kind of, you know, the emotions are frightening and scary, and just let's not show them to anyone, let alone to ourselves. There's a wide range of very strong attitudes people have to emotions in our society. And so probably all of you already have, consciously or unconsciously, a relationship to what we might call our emotional life. And it's very helpful in this process of mindfulness to reflect a little bit about what that relationship might be. And this is something you can do, go for a walk with a friend, journal, think about it somehow. But if you can kind of get some, kind of explore a little bit what your relationship is to your emotional life, then that relationship is less likely to hang up the process of mindfulness. Because as you pay attention to emotions, your relationship you have to emotions might interfere with the simplicity of just noticing it. Just noticing, oh, this is how it is. Right now I'm angry. Let's pay attention to this. Right now I'm happy. Let's just be very simply aware of that. As opposed to, great, I'm happy and I'm going to celebrate it and dance in the streets and... Or I'm angry and I'm going to go on, you know, really, that, you know, I really am justified in my anger and I'm going to let it rip, you know, or something, you know, to really kind of get into it. But, you know, they just be really simple with it. So part of mindfulness practice then is learning to bring a wise attention to our emotional life. What's important, though, is in talking about this, is Buddhism doesn't try to, for the most part, in mindfulness practice, we don't give special value to our emotions, different than the value we give to our physical experience, or our mental experience, our thoughts, or our breath. It's kind of, for the purposes of mindfulness and awareness, it's all equal. So, again, some people have these very strong ideas that the emotions are what they're about, and that's where everything's going to be experienced through their emotions. Or some people, it's like, emotions, no way. Not even close to that. And both of those are already having a relationship, a value established. And that it's a hierarchy of what's important and what's not. And mindfulness practice doesn't really have a hierarchy. It just is open awareness that it's willing to see everything as it is. A clear window doesn't have judgment about what's on the other side of the window. And many things will come through the past the window. So the mindfulness practice, we don't want to kind of excessively focus on emotions or, you know, insufficiently focus on them. We want to focus on them as it's appropriate. So before we do a meditation, there's a famous simile that the Buddha gave, called the simile of the arrows. And it has to do with the Buddha was talking to a gathering of people, and he asked them a question. He said, if a man is struck by an arrow, would that hurt the man? And the assembly said, yeah, you know, that would hurt to him. And then the Buddha said, well, if the person struck by a second arrow, same person struck by a second arrow, is that even more painful? And the people said, yeah, I mean, one's bad, but the second one makes it even worse. And so the Buddha said, in life sometimes brings you the first arrow. The second arrow is what you shoot at yourself. Basically, that's what he said. So if I'm walking down the street here and I stub my toe on the sidewalk, that's the first arrow. You know, things like that happen. You know, my toe hurts. The second arrow would be me telling myself, Gil, you are the worst walker. You're an embarrassment to humankind. And, you know, maybe you should only walk in places where people can't see you. You know, so I've added, you know, and then I see, oh, you know, I'm having all this negative judgments about myself. You know, I'm a Buddhist teacher. I shouldn't do that. And I'm really embarrassed. Then suddenly I'm embarrassed. Oh, no. And then I'm suffering because I shouldn't be doing this. And that's a third arrow. And then I get angry with myself. Here I am, embarrassed one more time. I should know better than that. And that's the fourth arrow. And so the arrows go on and on and on. And it's very important to distinguish between kind of what belongs to life, just comes with being a human being, and what are those second reactions that we have to it that adds to the suffering. This is a really important part of Buddhist of mindfulness practice. So you come here today with a headache or a backache. Those things happen. The Buddha had a bad back. You wouldn't believe it with his good posture. But he had a bad back, and sometimes he couldn't give his Dharma talk, and he laid down instead and had one of his senior disciples give the talk. It's kind of nice. I like it. You know? And so, you know, these things happen. And then one of the things we want to be very careful for is to distinguish, like last week we talked about distinguishing the commentary from the experience. We want to also distinguish the reaction we have to the primary situation. You know, are we adding a second arrow? Are we attacking it, criticizing it, running away? How are we reacting to it? So, you know, that's different than just letting it be there in its simplicity. And so part of the emotional life, some emotions belong to those second arrows. You know, anger sometimes is really a second arrow, like anger towards yourself. So there are a variety of emotions that belong to this world of second arrows. And again, we don't want... In mindfulness practice, we don't judge ourselves negatively. We're having second or third or fourth arrows. We try to wake up. We try to pay attention, notice this is what's going on. And it doesn't matter if you finally can wake up at the 130th arrow. It just matters that you wake up. Waking up meaning you just notice it, you're aware of it, and you don't add anything more. You find, oh, okay, this is what I'm doing. Because if you get to the 130th arrow and you say, this is terrible, I shouldn't be doing this, you know, then you've added 131st. So to add, you know, just some sooner or later, you either have to forget what you're doing, be distracted, or you have to just somehow, you know, wake up and just say, okay, enough. I just kind of step back and take the bigger picture here. Am I making some sense? Okay, so let's do a meditation. So take an alert, comfortable posture. Gently close your eyes. And then before doing anything else, take a few moments here to notice how you are, how you're feeling, what's your emotional state, your mood. Say there's always a mood or emotional state present, a mental state present, even if you don't recognize it. So how are you? And how are you about how you are? How are you relating to that? What's your judgments, ideas, thoughts? Reactions, if any. And if you do recognize how you're feeling, reflect a little bit about how the state of your feeling, emotional state, how it might influence how you relate, interpret, react to this period of meditation. If you're sitting here and you're grumpy, then are you likely to kind of interpret things in aversive ways as we go through here? If you're discouraged, are you likely to kind of carry a little burden of kind of being discouraged or kind of feel hopeless as you go about this? Is there some way in which your mood or emotional state could have an effect on this experience as we go forward. So then, take a few long, slow, deep breaths. It's a way of beginning here. So as you breathe in deeply, stretch, expand your rib cage, front and back, your shoulders. Feel the stretch, like a massage. And then a slow, long exhale where you relax and let go. Taking a deep breath in. And relax as you exhale. And then let your breathing return to normal. And scan through your body to see if there's any obvious places where you can soften the muscles, the holding that you might have. It might be possible to soften the muscles of the forehead, around the eyes and the jaws, cheeks. Especially as you exhale, maybe you can send a softening wave through your head. And also for your shoulders. Shoulder blades. Perhaps you can soften the muscles of your chest, rib cage area. Letting go of any holding. Pressure. It also can be helpful when you meditate to let your belly, your stomach be soft. Let it hang forward. Perhaps you can feel the weight of your belly and let gravity gently let it settle. Then within your body, as part of your bodily experience, become aware of how your body experiences breathing. And then see if you can compose yourself, compose your attention, your presence, around the experience of breathing, around the place in your body where you feel the breathing easiest or most pronounced. Settle around that area, compose yourself around it, and then begin to hang in there, hang out with the rhythm of breathing in and breathing out. The expansion and contraction. if your mind wanders away in thought. Relax, relax the thinking mind, and begin again with your breathing. Let go of what you're thinking about. And if you could stay with your breathing, and thoughts are in the background, just let them be there quietly in the background. You don't have to take care of them or attend to them, pick them up. If in the foreground you can stay with your breath, stay with breath, breathing in and breathing out. And notice when you shift from a simple awareness to what's happening to getting involved in commentary or getting involved in reactions. And if you can tease that apart, then return back to the simplicity of your breathing. If you find yourself reacting to what's going on, it might be helpful to very calmly, quietly whisper in the mind, name the reaction. Maybe reacting, reacting, or some other name. And maybe that helps kind of free yourself a little bit from being caught in it. And then after that few moments of recognition, come back again to your breathing. Trusting that for now, it's enough just to be aware of breathing. So then now let go of the focus on your breathing and instead, again, notice what is the emotional state that you have, the mood, the mental state, or if there's a kind of reactive state that's present. Very simply, okay, see if you can recognize that reactive state. And offer a kind of very simple awareness, like you're going to hang there with awareness, feeling what's happening, what you're feeling. And then see if you can find out where in your body that emotional or mental or state or mood is most manifested, most expressed. What sensations, what feelings in your body let you know that you're having this emotional state? Could be you're calm or agitated. Could be that you're impatient or content. Could be you're peaceful, agitated. Could be you're happy or sad, irritated, delighted, confused, eager. See if you can notice how the emotional state is expressed through your body, through sensations in your body. And if your mood or emotional state changes, goes away, notice what replaces it. And as you do this, you can also very, very quietly label it, name it, letting the naming of it help you be simple with it, independent of it, but still feeling it. So then the last minute of the sitting, come back again to your breathing and hang out with your breathing as if it's the most important place to be. Everything else can recede to the background. To say a few more words about the actual instructions for mindfulness. Generally encourage people to put the breathing at the center of the meditation. And with some encouragement to stay there, because focusing on the breath can help stabilize the mind, can help concentrate the mind, can help, you know, calm things down, strengthen the mindfulness. There's a lot of benefits with staying with the breathing. But if something else becomes more pronounced, more predominant, more compelling than the breath, then the instruction is to let go of the breathing and take your meditative awareness, take your awareness and shift it to this other thing that's happening. And kind of basically meditate with that. Bring your awareness to that. Just cultivate your mindfulness, your present moment awareness on that experience. So if it's something in your body, some strong sensations in your body, then rather than thinking of the sensations as a distraction, we take them as just something new to develop our meditation on. So if it's for new meditators, it's often they have to deal with discomfort. So within reason, you know, we simply move our attention to the discomfort and we hold it in awareness. We explore it with awareness, trying to be really simple, not getting caught up in the reactions we have, might, aversions we might have to it or fears we might have to it, and just be present for it. If there's compelling or loud sounds, again, we don't treat it as distractions. We just, okay, now I'll do listening meditation. We let go of the breath in a calm way. Just open up and take in the sounds as long as they're there. Just in the sounds are always, some sounds always happen in the present moment. You're in the present moment when you're with the sound. And do mindfulness of sound. Be present for that. Experience that fully. So the same thing with emotions. If emotions become pronounced, compelling, predominant, then they become the meditation subject. So again, you can let go of your breath and you take in the experience, the emotion. Now it's a little bit tricky with emotions because some people get very easily entangled with their emotions. They get involved with them, or they resist them, or they judge them, or do something with them. The trick is to have this very simple awareness that simply knows, is present for the experience of the emotion as it is, as it's going through us. And So there's a number of steps or aspects, I would say, to mindfulness of emotions. And the first one is the recognition that now an emotion has become compelling. Now emotion has become predominant. Now there's an emotion that needs our attention. And sometimes that's not so easy for some people because some people are a little bit disconnected to their emotions. And so there could be actually be an emotion which is really a really important event. It's really having a big influence and effect on us. However, we kind of dismiss it or don't really think it's important. We think other things are more important, like our thoughts or stories. And so we kind of like, it can be a dismissal of them or not paying attention to them and not valuing them. So part of mindfulness is always to learn to recognize when an emotion is present that needs attention. And so the recognition, oh, here it is. Now sometimes it hits us over the head, the emotion, it's really clear. So the recognition part is pretty straightforward. So just to recognize you're having some kind of emotional experience, a mood or something. The second aspect I like to call acceptance or allowance. And this is not being in any kind of conflict with the emotional experience you're having. So allowing it to be there in its freedom, allowing it to be there as it is. And I like to say meditation practice is a safe place to have your full range of emotions. And you're welcome when you meditate to have murderous rage. Now, I don't know if it's, you know, such a good idea in other aspect areas of your life. And you might have to be wise about murderous rage, you know, elsewhere, how much you show it, you know. If you have murderous rage towards your boss, you know, maybe it's not so wise to let it go, you know, just let it be there. But meditation is this beautiful place where you can, you know, you're safe, you're committed to not moving. And so you can just let it course through you and really be there, you know, as it needs to be.
You wouldn't see that as a second arrow.
What?
A rage like that.
Oh, is a murderous rage a second arrow? It's possible it's a, you know, 130th arrow. But the point is that if it's there, then if you think, oh, that's a second arrow, it shouldn't be there, that you've added the third arrow. And so once it's there, in meditation, we give this permission. Okay, let it be there. So I call it, sometimes it's called acceptance, allowance, non-conflict, permission to be there. And for some people, that's a huge, training. To train oneself or to develop oneself so that one can be present for an emotional state while giving it permission to be there. And permission for it to be there does not same thing as resistance to it or judging it or being in conflict with it, but giving permission to be there is also not the same thing as giving into it. So, you know, so, oh, I've heard that, you know, meditate, I can, you know, it's, you know, I can allow murderous rage. So you just, okay, I'm really going to, you know, let it pump it up and really kind of let it flow and really get into it because it feels so good. Yes! You know, that's kind of getting entangled with it. That's not simplicity of awareness either. So the idea is not to add on it, not to fuel it, not to get engaged in it, but also not to repress it. So in mindfulness meditation offers this wonderful, in a kind of middle way, this wonderful third alternative of to repression on one side and expression on the other. So if you're expressing it, then you've gotten involved. If you're repressing it, then you're entangled. But what we're trying to do with it in sitting still, in mindfulness, is just let it be there, neither repressed nor expressed. Make sense? Now, some people, that's a strange idea because it seems like expression is what it is. But anyway, so they just sit there. So first is to recognize it's there. The second is to allow it, accept it. It's, you know, takes a while to learn that. Don't feel like you can do that overnight. Depending on, you know, those various and different emotions, you know, how you can, well, you can do that. And then the third is to name it. This mental noting that often is done in our tradition, use a very simple label. And, you know, in the ancient folk tales, if you name the dragon loses its power. Or in some traditional cultures, you're given a birth name, but you shouldn't tell your birth name to anybody because then they have a certain kind of power over you. There's power in naming. And so there's something about naming our experience which sometimes takes the power away from the experience. The power that comes from being identified with it, being entangled with it, being reactive to it, or feeding it or something. And so very simply, in a kind of simple, calm, kind of as calm as you can in your mind, just name it. Anger is there. Or happy, or sad. And the idea is with that naming of it, you're trying to kind of name it from a place in your being where you're not caught by it. You know, it's lost in it, being swept up in it, whatever it might be. So if you do the mental noting, and you say, when you're happy, you say, oh, happy. you're in it. You know, just say happy. And if you're, angry, and you go, anger, you're in it. Just anger. So that part of you that doesn't, so you're trying to find that place in you that's not entangled or caught in the experience. Not by repressing it or pushing it away, but just finding that adult-like place that can just kind of be present in a stable way. Also, the mental noting has a function of being a gentle encouragement to you, a nudge, stay present. So when there's emotions, emotions don't disappear that quickly usually, so if some emotion stays for a while, just kind of ongoing, kind of steady way, just name it, happy or angry. And it's also a little bit of encouragement, stay there, because the mind has such a strong tendency to wander off. So stay there. And one of the strong places it wanders can wander off in, when there's emotions, it can wander off into the story. Some emotions are strongly connected to stories. In fact, I could be sitting, meditating, minding my own business, and there is a sound of a car drives by. And, I'm feeling really peaceful. I hear the sound of the car, and it reminds me of the kind of car that rear-ended me 32 years ago. And then the anger wells up. And their anger wells up partly because of this. I'm remembering the story. That person in that car, and how could they drive that kind of car? Why'd they drive that kind of way? And I should have given them peace of my mind. And pretty soon, I'm kind of like in this world. I'll tell you a story of when I taught a retreat many years ago. So I teach retreats and week-long 10-day meditation retreats. And there was a woman who had been coming to meditation retreats for a long time. But she was a very troubled woman, emotionally troubled. And she'd been struggling with her emotions for a long time and kind of tortured by them in many ways. And one morning, we had a magical sitting, it seemed like. We were all meditating together, teachers and the retreatants. And it was early morning, or not early, it was like 10 o'clock in the morning. And there was a beautiful winter light coming through. It was very still and peaceful and very clear. And you kind of feel the whole room got so still, so not just still, but clear and peaceful. And bell rang to end the sitting, and like no one wanted to get up. It was just like felt so good. But it happened to be that her and I had an interview right after that sitting. So we both found our way up to the interview room, and I sat in my chair, and she came in to her, sat in her chair. And it was really clear that she was in an altered state, or altered, but she was really peaceful. I'd never seen her that way. She was peaceful, she was content, she was there, very simple way. It didn't feel like we had to say anything. I felt the same way. It didn't seem like we had to say anything. We just sat there a little bit, looked at each other, and it's like, great, what do you say when you're at peace? And then we said a few words, and then she said to me, yeah, this is nice, but it wasn't this way yesterday. And then she started telling me yesterday, her features and her form and her emotions all got kind of completely wrapped up, and she was like, and I said, oh no, why did she have to start telling me the story of yesterday? Why couldn't she just stay with what was here? So it was an example of how story making can really kind of entangle us in this whole world of emotions. And so what we try to do when we do mindfulness of emotions, we try not to live in the stories. Stories about emotional stories, stories connected to emotions, are usually not real-time stories, not here-and-now kind of stories. about what's happening now. They're usually stories about what happened before, what might happen in the future. And so they're a little bit, you know, a virtual reality. And so the idea in mindfulness meditation is not get sucked into the story. And that's hard for some people because they spend a lifetime in the stories. And so the idea is to come back. And so by naming the experience, you know, we're more likely to stay here, stay here, stay here. Don't go into the story. Stay here. Don't go into the story. Anger, anger. Oh, that person. And anger, come back. Be here. That's a story. That's a story. That's a commentary. Come back and just be with this. Be with the immediacy of what's actually here, with the anger. Be with the emotion of anger. Don't be with the story that's fueling it or connecting to it, or that feeds off it or is feeding it. So, the recognition, the acceptance, the naming, and then the last thing I call investigation. And that is, once you have the ability to accept it, to recognize it, accept it, and to start naming it, to be present for it, then be curious about it, look into it. What is this experience? Don't just hold it at a distance, say, I'm present, I'm present. Get closer, to find out, what is this? How is anger really experienced? How do you really experience it in your body? How do you experience it in your stomach? How do you experience it in your jaws? How do you experience it temperature-wise? What's actually being experienced when you're angry? What's the energy like in your system? Kind of begin to explore it. And that exploration is investigating, is a movement of the mind which is adult-like, which is independent, which is not kind of coward or not reactive to the experience, but just kind of, what is this experience? Very simple. Kind of, what is this? And one of the things that's very helpful with emotions is to explore, investigate how it is experienced in your body. What's the physical manifestation of it? And virtually every emotion you're going to have is not only going to be expressed in your body, but kind of almost like is your body. It's like you wouldn't know what emotion you're having unless there were some kind of emotion, some kind of sensations in your body corresponded with it. So, you know, some people, if they're afraid, their stomach will get tight, so that tightness will be there, or their shoulders get lifted up. Or if you're happy, you feel this softening that goes on, this warmth or this tingling. If you're sad, you can feel the heaviness and the weight and the droopiness. So there's shifts and changes that happen in your body. So bring your attention closer to that physical side of the emotion. Feel the physical side of it. That's one way of avoiding getting caught up in the stories, because the body is not a story. And then you're still connecting to the emotion. You're present for it, you're present for how it is in the body. And also, the body, in a sense, has a wisdom of its own. It's kind of like some emotions are fueled by the story-making mind. When they're experienced or manifested in the body, the body wants to go to homeostasis. Body wants to go to healing, wants to come back to peace. So when I teach mindfulness of emotion to kids, little kids, like 7, 8-year-old kids or something, I have them act out an emotion for me. So I say, okay, now everybody kind of show me how you're angry. That's really cute. You know, a room full of, you know, 7, 8-year-olds trying to show them they're angry, how angry they are. And then I say, okay, now everyone freeze. And they're all freezing in different positions, right? And then I say, okay, now to stop being angry, what do you need to do with your body? And then they kind of all relax their bodies. So it's a way of teaching them how to pay attention to the emotions and to show the connection to their body and how their body can be an aid to having some mastery over their emotion, not be caught by it. And they love it. I mean, they've never done it. They had so much fun. So to drop into the body and feel it in the body. So the body wants to go. It doesn't want to stay up tense. The body wants to relax. And so those emotions which involve tension, there's a movement that the body wants to, if the body's left alone, the body will relax. The body doesn't relax because the mind keeps reasserting its tension, its clinging, its resistance. So if you can drop down into the body and feel the emotion as a physical experience, you're kind of getting out of the way. You're not, you know, just the body. And the body has a chance to open up and allow the motion to course through, to move, to evolve, and to resolve and dissolve. So in that line, I'm fond of the fact that the word emotion in English comes from the Latin word motion. Isn't that nice? Movement. And the E part, the prefix means out, so the move out. So all emotions are processes, and they're processes and they want to move out, they want to move, unless they're frozen. So resentment is frozen anger. And, to kind of misquote Charlie Brown, bad grief is frozen grief. You know, grief is grief. Everyone experiences that sooner or later. But then there's grief which can be frozen. So certain emotions get frozen, and then the process, the evolution, the movement doesn't happen. But left alone, all emotions would move through. That's one of the reasons why sometimes certain emotions we say, well, I just have to give this time. If you give it time, things will sometimes settle and, you know, to some degree take care of themselves. So if we can experience the emotions as an embodied experience, as they occur in our body, the emotional life has an easier time to move through us, to change and shift. And it shifts in different ways. Sometimes it resolves and quiets down. Sometimes it gets stronger before it gets freer. So sometimes you feel a little bit of irritation, and you could be present for that. And that irritation, because you're present for it, kind of explodes like this big volcano of resentment, huge fury. And fury was buried deep inside and finally has a chance to come out. So it's not like a linear process. As soon as you're mindful, it goes from worse to better. There's this wisdom or this kind of movement of inner life that we trust in mindfulness, just trust it. And as long as you're mindful, it can go in all kinds of different directions. And we consider that to be part of the healing or part of the resolution or the movement it has to take. And just stay present, stay present, stay present, and watch it go through its shifts and changes. So in that last meditation, I asked you at the beginning and at the end to notice your emotions, your emotional state, your mood. So what was that like for some of you? What happened to you? What did you notice when you actually brought your attention to that part of your experience?
I noticed when I'm sitting here, it's always generally pleasant. It's when I go out there that things arise. So I always have a very nice connotation with sitting and I see. And but what I've noticed with meditation would help going out there is that what you described last time or the time before, where you get more space, there's less reactivity to whatever might come up. So I'm usually not as calm or whatever out there, but have a little bit better handle on what arises and what's coming up and can see it a little bit better.
Great. Thank you. So someone else, a little bit about what happened when you focused on your emotions in the last sitting. Anybody want to say a few things? So if you can use a mic, and some people can't hear unless they use the hearing system.
I was tempted to share, so maybe I should just hold this. When you asked us at the very beginning to identify our emotion, I actually came in tonight feeling very low. And I tried to find it, like you said, in where it might lie. And which I found it up in sort of the front part of my forehead. But then, and I identified it, you know, put a label on it, like, oh, there it is. But then I didn't know what to do with it. I tried not to change it. I tried not to focus in on it too much. I just sort of let it be there, but it's still there.
Okay. So it's a good question. And one place to start with investigating that question is do you have some expectation of what's supposed to happen? Like it's supposed to go away. So that's commentary, that's extra. So it's very important to recognize that that's operating, because things like that can operate very subtly in the background and have a big influence on your experience. But if it's not acknowledged, it can actually be a kind of an irritant for the whole system. So if you acknowledge it, maybe you can drop it. And once you drop the expectation that it's supposed to go away, then maybe it's less of a problem. So that's one thing. The other is, it's not a meditator's job to be concerned about how long something stays. A meditator's job is simply to use whatever's happening as the vehicle, as the means for developing greater mindfulness, staying present. So we often come with ideas that shouldn't be there, supposed to fix things, something's supposed to happen. In mindfulness meditation, we actually try to free ourselves from the idea that something is supposed to happen. We're just trying to use whatever is happening as a way of developing stronger mindfulness. And so if you're feeling low, say, okay, it's, you know, it's kind of a drag, but I guess this is the task today, is to cultivate mindfulness of the low, that low feeling. And so you so first of all, you can look, are you really recognizing it accurately? Are you accepting it? Is there a sense of allowing there? Are you not in conflict with it? Then name it gently. You stay with it. Learn to stay with it. And then you can start investigating it more. In investigation, you know, you can go and feel the different sensations more carefully in your head. You can look more closely. You can look from below and top and explore it different ways. Feel your way into it. Is it just in your skin, or does it feel like it's deep in your skull? If you bring yourself really close to it, with the awareness really close, what does it look like? What does it feel like? You know, does it feel like a solid thing, or is it made up of a pattern of different sensations that are rising and passing? When you get close, what happens to it? And generally, when you get close enough to some physical experience, it begins shifting and changing. And then you stay with the shifts and changes. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. I think one of the hardest expectations that I'm dealing with, even I did your exercises on the pink sheet of eating very slowly and just being with yourself as you eat. My God, that was one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. next to childbirth. But it was... I do have an expectation that at the end of my meditation that I will be at peace or more peaceful. And that's a very hard expectation to let go of.
Yes, and it's to be expected that people have that expectation, because that's, we often kind of advertise meditation as being, you know, peacemaking and calm-making and all that, and that's what people want it. But, it's nice when it happens, it's good that it happens. Ultimately, we want that to happen. But if it happens too quickly sometimes, or we expect it, we mess up the whole deeper process, deeper psychological, spiritual process that we need to go through. So, for example, I've known people who have gone through, had very difficult meditation sessions, maybe like sometimes a whole retreat. And sometimes they end up meditation session, well, that was a waste of time. You know, I should have just gone for a walk, or, you know, watch television or something, but that was just a boy. And then they come back, you know, and then they come back sometime later and say, you know something? That meditation practice, that session or that retreat was so hard for me. But what I learned was I learned how to stay present in difficult situations. Because it was really difficult for me to stay present. I learned how to be present. And so I didn't know at the time how useful it was. But later, I was in the hospital with my so-and-so, and it was like awful, confusing time, and everyone was angry with each other. And because I learned to do it, because I had hung in there with that difficult meditation, I learned something about hanging in there in difficult situations where I had to hang in there. And normally I would have made a mess of it. So sometimes what we think of as a bad meditation, agitated, uncalm, upset, painful meditation, sometimes it's actually better than a calm one. So that's, you know, maybe I shouldn't say that in the intro class, but it's the case. Yes.
Well, I had, can you hear me? Anxiety, so I thought, that's inappropriate. I'm so anxious, but meditating doesn't. So I thought it was inappropriate to be so anxious in meditating, so I tried breathing and thinking, okay, the anxiety will go away. And then once I was breathing all right, I was so anxious. So you said, okay, just go with that. So I had a wave of anxiety, but I thought, okay, I'll just breathe. That's all right. And it was very interesting. It was just what you described. So a big wave came, and I had to think about that. And when it got really scary, I was breathing. So I learned to separate from that and at least keep breathing.
Beautiful.
Oh,
it can give you a lot of power in your life to have that ability. There's a practice that I teach people sometimes, which I kind of labeled riding out an emotion or riding out the desire. So you want to wait until you, like, this is good for people who have addiction issues. Like if you have a really big addiction, it could be anything. And wait when you have a really juicy one, like a really strong, juicy desire, like you really got to have that, whatever it is. And so when that time comes, go sit down in a chair. Sit down. And don't give into it. Write it out. And sit there and all the lawyers of the mind come out and will explain why you have to you can't sit there, why you have to do something and go to do it. And you quiet the lawyers and then the publicities come out and the commercials come out and all this tremendous surge of energy. You feel like you're going to die if it's not going to happen. You know, it's like this tremendous compulsions can be really powerful with addictions. But you're committed to not, it's like being at the rodeo. You're just like, you're not going to leave. You're not going to fall off your horse. And sooner or later, it's guaranteed, the wave is going to crest. And then you'll find yourself on the other side. And you'll get calm eventually, quiet down eventually. And the people I've known who then have hung in there for a really good one, good wave, and watched it come to the other side, have felt so empowered in the life. Wow, I can be stronger than my addiction. I can be stronger than these very powerful emotions. I learn how to be present for it, to breathe through it, to be present. So you had one here earlier, right? You still want to?
Actually, mine was very similar to the first one. I came in feeling irritated, and then when I gave my irritation some attention or that, then I felt quite sorry for myself, and then I felt sad, So and I was annoyed because I usually feel better when I'm meditating. So, And it's, I didn't know as well when you said, labeled reaction, if we were to say labeled reaction or to kind of actually name what reaction it was.
Yeah, you could either one. You can name reaction. The idea with that, the labeling can be very helpful, but it's not helpful if you spend a lot of time kind of figure out what the right name is, what the right label is. Try this and that and if it's not obvious, then just say reaction. Or if you're not obvious what emotion you're having, sometimes it's not obvious, but some emotions happen, you say emotion. So I remember once I was feeling off, and I didn't quite know what was going on, but I certainly felt off. So I went and lay down, and then I was just, because I, this practice I know how to do, I then kind of went into my body to feel what was going on in my body, when this offness, I didn't know what it was. And I could feel that I couldn't exhale all the way. That somehow my chest was extended. It's like I'd breathed in fully, but then I couldn't breathe out all the way. So I held out. So I started feeling that for a while. And then as I felt that for a while, somehow it became clear in my mind, or popped into my mind, that I was depressed. So I said, oh, depressed. And as soon as I named the depression, the chest relaxed. But first I just started off, you know. I just was content with that. And then at some point the clarity came. But it came on its own. It wasn't like I was guessing or analyzing. Keep it really simple. Somebody else want to share? Maybe one more here.
So I woke up this morning and I felt something and I labeled it fear. Told myself where it was in my body, wrote about it at work, and then I thought about the fourth step of investigation. I came here, we meditated. You said, pick an emotion, and I was trying to reach for that one in the morning, but I had no emotion to pick. And I thought that was very interesting because I'm like, well, wow. But then I got stuck on investigation. I'm like, okay, so now that I've done those three steps, shouldn't something be happening? Shouldn't I be asking fear questions? Shouldn't I be, doing more investigation of those body symptoms. And I just didn't know what to do after that, and I guess I wasn't supposed to do anything.
Right. And nothing has to happen in this practice. You know, the idea that something's supposed to happen is just another commentary, another judgment, an idea. Nothing has to happen. If something happens, that's okay. But don't burden yourself if something has to happen. Just be present. Okay, nothing's happening. Being present when nothing's happening. Now I'm bored. Now something's happening. Now I get to do boredom meditation. And you can write, you know, okay, I've been told that I have to take boredom as my subject. So I guess I'll just write my PhD on boredom. I'll really get to know it well. You enter into boredom. You really feel that. But they have only nothing, you know, free yourself from some ideas that something is supposed to happen. But on the other hand, there's always some mood that's going on. It might not be something you recognize very well. It might not be familiar with. And that might be very vague. It might be something you don't think of as a mood or emotional state. There was one woman on retreat who came to interview to a teacher and said, you know, I'm feeling something really strange. I don't quite know what it is, but so the teacher said something like, oh, well, just keep investigating, keep being present. And then she came back the next interview a few days later and said, I discovered what it is. I'm calm. And I'd never been calm in my life before, and so I couldn't recognize it. Yes.
This feels like a stupid question, but I have to ask it. I wasn't feeling an emotion, but I was feeling sleepy. So at some point when you said, you know, see if you have an emotion and then feel it, I just said, I'm sleepy.
That's good.
Stayed with that.
Yeah, being sleepy is maybe not an emotion, but being, but you know, maybe it's the same thing, but being tired or being having sloth and torpor, you know, that's kind of a state you're in. You feel a sloth and torpor state, so you can kind of go into the state and feel that and explore that. So emotion, mood, mental state, it's kind of a very wide field. And this is very interesting because, the word emotion is really big here in the West in English speakers. You know, we have like people, you know, like I said, they'll fight over their opinions about what to do with emotions. And there's no easy word in Buddhist languages for the English word emotion. If you know, you can't easily translate. You can kind of do it, but it's kind of hard. So what does that mean? The emotion, Buddhists don't have emotions? Emotion is kind of like the pie of human experience can be divided up different ways. And the English language divides it up a particular way and has a pie section called emotions. But it's kind of a generalization. It's kind of a general category term. It's very vague and general what emotion is. So mood, emotional state. So it's interesting to explore what makes up an emotion. Emotions often are made up of physical sensations. Sometimes they're made up of motivation, desire, something we want. Sometimes they're made up of stories we tell each other. Sometimes they're made up of feelings of being pleasant or unpleasant. It's kind of made up of, they're kind of composite anyway. So because they're not a unitary thing, singular thing, so they're you can explore, you know, the different aspects of them. Now, one of the things about emotions or emotional states or mental states is that Buddhism distinguishes between emotions or emotional states, moods, mental states, which are born out of reactions, reactivity, or are born in relationship to things in the world, versus emotions which arise when actually the system, the inner system, the heart, the mind, the body, is open, channels free, and present and stable, but doesn't have is not reacting or responding to anything. So many emotions have to do with our relationships with things around us. So for example, if I win the lottery, then if I follow the usual pattern, apparently that scholars have read, people, you know, studied people who win lotteries, if I follow the usual pattern, then I'll be really happy at first. And then after a year later, I feel pretty miserable. And so the happiness and the misery has to do a lot with, you know, the things in the world, my relationship with things in the world. Or when I was, when I was 13, it was 1967, those of you who are old enough to remember that wonderful time. And I was living in a little town in Italy. And I'd come from California. And so that summer I was living in Italy. And so I had the longest hair of any guy in that little town. And I was the only one with blue jeans. And having long hair back then, you know, was a big deal. So, for guys. And so I was really cool. Thank you. I'm glad you appreciate that. And so I went around town with a certain kind of good feeling for myself. I felt up and, you know, nice and, you know, good. It's great. And then in the summer I came back to Los Angeles. And a lot had happened in California in the summer of 1967. And I no longer had the longest hair of the guys. And I went to school. I was kind of pulling my hair to try to get it longer because I was so uncool. And they had figured out to somehow, you know, put their jeans through washing machines 50 times. And some people actually put their jeans out in the road and cars would drive over them. And people would cut them up and patch them up. And, you know, and I just had blue jeans. And so I was no longer cool. And so I felt kind of deflated and kind of embarrassed, and I was pulling my hair to make it grow faster. And, you know, it was like, and so, you know, the only thing that happened was I'd crossed the Atlantic, you know, and my energy level, my mood and everything. And that's an example of how my mood, my emotional state existed in relationship to some other people. Okay? So we have all these experiences in life. People like us, they don't like us. We have success in life, we have failure in life. We get what we want, we don't get what we want. You know, there's all these things that happen. We get sick, we get healthy. And so all these things can affect our mood and our emotional state. And some degree that's normal and healthy. To some degree, it can be very unhealthy to be completely caught up in the world of how always be in a relationship, always have our emotional state, our well-being, always tied to some, to always tied or relating to the experiences of the world, to how things are in the world. Because then you're just kind of like a slave. You're always going to be pushed around by the winds of the world. So then that's one kind of emotion that arises, emotions that arise because of our relationship with the world. And there's a whole other category of emotional state or mental states which have much more to do with not being in relationship, where we're not caught in the relationships. We're independent, we're free, we're liberated from all that reaction for and against, and everything goes on. And the system just open and flowing. And there's a tremendous amount of what can be called unrelated joy, unrelated happiness, unrelated peace. So peace, joy, happiness, it bubbles up, not because anything in the world is going right or wrong. It just kind of like in the system, it flows up. It doesn't have a reason or a cause or a condition or a catalyst for it in how things are going in the world. And that's a phenomenal thing, to discover a happiness and well-being that's not dependent on how things are going. And part of the possibility, as we do this practice and learn how to kind of just be present for things as they are and free yourselves from the commentary and the reactions, just be present, is in time you'll discover this tremendous treasure. And it's a source of tremendous power also in your life, of a happiness and well-being that doesn't require you to win the lottery or to have people like you or think well of you or do this, you know, this or that. And so there's two different realms. And generally the shift over time for people who do meditation practice is they start shifting to having more and more of the unrelated, you know, emotions away from the related ones or the, you know, reactive ones or something. So, but the key to doing that and making that shift or the personal growth that happens in through meditation has a lot to do with the very simple thing, just stay present in a very simple way and be present for what is. Don't be present for what you want to happen. Just be present for what is happening and try to be as simple as you can with that. Try not to have an agenda. Try not to have commentary. If you do have agendas, if you have commentaries, all you're asked to do then is to know that that's there. Just know that's there. Know it's there. Know it's there. Know it's there. Keep it really simple. Stay in the knowing. Stay, this is what's happening now. This is what's happening now. This is happening now. And see if you can avoid adding a second arrow. And if you add a second arrow, just be very allowing of that. Okay, there's a second arrow. Wow. That's what a second arrow is like, as opposed to shoot. And then you have the third arrow. So it takes a while to get a hang of this. But I hope that you're getting a little bit of sense of how this practice is done. It's meant to be very, very simple. And because it's so simple, some people it takes a while to get a hang of it. Because we always think we have to do something, this and that. Make sense? So there is a handout for today. And so, you know, explore it a little bit and practice with this emotion, practice with emotions over the next... wait a moment, please. All the rustling distracts me. I still have 3 more minutes of your time. I shouldn't have said anything. Over the next week, see if you can get into your emotional life in terms of being, explore it, be interested in it, notice how it works, both in meditation but also outside. And also you might do people watching, you know, look at other people and see if you can pick up their emotions and feel what's going on. Also, you might hang out with some people, colleagues, friends, neighbors, anybody, strangers, and engage them and ask them about their emotional life. Not so much, you know, what emotions you're having and your dark secrets of your life and all that, but more, a little bit more abstractly, how do you relate to emotions? What's your relationship to emotions? How do you work with emotions? What do you do with them? Maybe find someone you think is wise and ask them, you know, how do you relate? What have you learned about, what wise things have you learned about the emotions? So kind of get into emotions this week. And part of the reason is that just the more you know about it, the easier it is to be free of it and to practice with it. But another reason is that the more you're familiar with the world of emotions, the easier it'll be to understand next week's instructions, which is going to be mindfulness of thinking. Because thinking has a very close connection to emotions, and it's easier to be free of your thinking if you know how to be free in relationship to your emotions. They're connected. So thank you very much, and so we'll see you next week.